Good morning. On behalf of the College of Law, it is my pleasure to welcome you to the 10th Annual Fisher Lecture in Law and Medicine. This lecture is made possible through the generosity of Dr. Tom and Jean Clark, who created the Clark Family Lecture Series at West Virginia University. Susie and my friendship with Tom and Jean go back 44 years to the days when we were newlyweds and students at West Virginia University. Tom was in medical school, and I was in law school. And Jean and Susie worked so that Tom and I could pursue our respective careers. In the years that followed, Dr. Tom has cared for my family as a physician and as a friend. And Jean and I worked together in the president's office when Gordon Gee was the president at West Virginia University. While it has been 44 years since we were young graduate students living in Sunnyside, and over two decades since Jean and I worked together in the president's office, the friendships that developed years ago have remained steadfast. In the years since their graduation from West Virginia University, the Clarks have enjoyed success in their professional and their business activities, and they have remembered the university that provided them the foundation for their success. The Clarks endowed 10 separate lectureships in different colleges of the university, and in doing so, they honored others who had been part of their lives, either in a professional or personal sense. I am deeply honored and appreciative that Tom and Jean have endowed one of those lectureships in the College of Law, and it will forever link our respective professions. And I'm also honored that it represents an extremely important friendship. And as a result of these endowments, we have been able to bring to our College of Law speakers of national prominence to speak on topics of importance. I'm also very appreciative that Tom and Jean and their family have endowed the Franklin D. Cleckley Scholarship in our College of Law. They have honored their good friend and our colleague, Frank. And as a result of this scholarship, the financial burdens for one of our students is lessened. And personally, I thank Tom and Jean for honoring me. And as dean, I thank them for this lectureship for the law school and the scholarship honoring Professor Cleckley. Not only have Tom and Jean shared their financial resources, they have also given generously of their time and talents to help our university. Jean is a member of the West Virginia University Foundation Board, and Tom is a member of the West Virginia University Board of Governors, and served as one of the original members of the board of the director of the Blanchette Rockefeller Institute, which is working to find cures to Alzheimer's and other neurological disorders. In addition to their dedication and generous and loyal support of WVU, Tom and Jean have likewise been generous and significant supporters of a number of important community activities. Evidence of the significance of their contribution to the Morgantown community is the fact that they were the recipients in 2006 of the Mylan Pushcart Award for outstanding commitment to the community, and was honored at a banquet at which Governor Manchin and Congressman Mullahan were the featured speakers. We thank their clerks for their service to our university and to the Morgantown community. Tom is with us today, and I'd ask you to please stand so we can show our appreciation. While it is my privilege to introduce the lecture series, Professor Charles DeSalvo will have the honor of introducing our speaker today. However, I do want to add to Professor DeSalvo's introduction my appreciation to our speaker for his accepting our invitation to be here. Sure.
Over the years, we've been lucky to have some very prestigious people speak in this lecture series. We've had lawyer and Professor Barry Scheck of the Innocence Project, all the way to Dr. Sidney Wolfe of Public Health, whom I'm sure many of you have seen interviewed on national television over and over. And this year we have another prestigious guest. Our speaker's chief concern over the past few years has been with issues that arise at the intersection of health law and ethics. He has a prodigious record of scholarship, having published in the leading ethics and bioethics journals of our time, and of late, he's focused on the subject of today's presentation, which has to do, of course, with conscientious objection on the part of pharmacists. In fact, he recently published an article on this topic in a journal that's published by the Kennedy Institute of Ethics at Georgetown that draw our attention to him. And Cambridge University Press, the most respected academic publishing house in the world, has recently given him a contract to write a book on this very topic. But he's not just a scholar, he's also a very accomplished teacher. He's won numerous awards for his teaching. He teaches a variety of courses on ethics, and I'm happy also to say a course on the philosophy of law. But he's not just a speaker, he's not just a teacher. He puts his work to practical use as well. He began serving on ethics committees at hospitals in 1985, and he continues that service today. He served as a reviewer for peer-reviewed journals, and he's delivered so many professional papers and presentations, you wonder whether the man ever sleeps. Where did we go to obtain a speaker whose scholarship is nationally known, whose reputation as a teacher is superb, and whose professional productivity practically defies belief? We went to the philosophy department of West Virginia University, the academic home of our distinguished colleague, Professor Mark Wicclair. Professor Wicclair, we are honored to have you. Welcome to the College of Law.
Oh, thank you, Chuck, and I'm delighted to be here. I've scanned the room, and I've spotted at least two of my former students. I thought they had better judgment than to come for more of me, but I'm glad to see them here. And I thought before we start getting into really heavy stuff, let's start off with a little bit of lighthearted. And I don't know if you can make this out, but this is the sign says Garden of Eden Pharmacy, and the little sign there says no immoral prescriptions will be filled. The pharmacist, and then the little tiny thing, which I can't even read, says, and who decides what is immoral? And the little figure there says, I do. So just a little bit of lighthearted entertainment to get us going. Now, what I thought might be a good way of getting started is to focus on an actual case. And this is a case that happened in Chicago in February 2008. You may have heard about it. A pharmacist there in the Chicago Loop area refused to fill prescriptions for two women for emergency contraception. And basically what he told them is, I don't fill those prescriptions. This pharmacist worked for a Jewel Osco pharmacy. The pharmacy responded that the pharmacist had acted perfectly appropriately, consistent with their policy and consistent with state law. The state licensing board didn't agree with them, and they filed a complaint against the pharmacy. And what they claimed is that this was not appropriate care, pharmaceutical care, and it was unprofessional conduct. Now, as a result of that, the governor of Illinois issued about a month later, he issued what was called an emergency rule. And basically, what this rule required is that any pharmacy that carries and sells, dispenses contraceptives, has to fill all prescriptions for contraceptives, including emergency contraception. And then they went on to say that if emergency contraception or any contraceptive isn't in stock, the pharmacy is obligated to order it according to its normal policies, or if the client or patient prefers, to refer the client or patient to another pharmacy that has it in stock. And in August of 2005, this emergency rule became a permanent rule in Illinois. Now, as you might expect, there was the reaction to this emergency rule and then permanent rule was mixed. Some people thought, right on, that's exactly right. We've got to show these pharmacies that they can't discriminate against women who want emergency contraception. On the other hand, there were some people who were violently in protest and thought that this violated the rights of pharmacists to exercise their conscience, to follow their moral and religious beliefs. Now, to some extent, some of that protest misunderstood the emergency rule. Now, you're all lawyers, so you probably have attended to this, but basically the emergency rule did not apply to pharmacists. It applied to pharmacies, and it required pharmacies that stock, that dispense contraceptives to also dispense emergency contraception. It did not require any pharmacies to dispense contraceptives, so the pharmacy could decide just not to dispense any contraceptives at all, and it didn't say anything about pharmacists. Now, what I want to focus on today is pharmacists and not pharmacies. Let me just say something very quickly about pharmacies. I think there's a different case with respect to pharmacies because of their obligation to serve the public in terms of their health needs. So I think something like this emergency rule is probably ethically justified, and it doesn't say anything about whether or not individual pharmacists may or may not refuse on the basis of conscience. But what I, as I said, what I want to focus on today is pharmacists and specifically their conscientious objection to emergency contraception. Now, interestingly, after I wrote this article, as Chuck said, for the Kennedy Institute Journal, actually before it got published, but between the time it was accepted and published, the FDA finally, after I don't know how many decades, approved emergency contraception for, for without a prescription. I almost misspoke and said over-the-counter. It wasn't over-the-counter. What they did is they said that women over 18 and over did not need a prescription for emergency contraception. Now, you might think, well, okay, that's the end of it. Why are we talking about this anymore? Women don't need prescriptions for EC. That's the end of it. Well, unfortunately, that's not the end of it, because the way this was introduced by the FDA is that, well, okay, it doesn't require a prescription, but it can't be sold anywhere else except in pharmacies. It can't be sold in convenience marts, quickie marts, whatever. Can't be sold in supermarkets. And in addition to that, women under the age of 18 need a prescription. Well, if that's the case, then it can't be available over the counter because you can't enforce it. So every woman who wants emergency contraception still has to go to the pharmacist and request it. And if the woman looks like she might be a little bit like close to 18, she has to be asked for her identification. So in this respect, then, the action by the FDA did not completely remove the controversy about emergency contraception, because somebody still behind the pharmacy counter, somebody still has to be in charge of deciding who is and isn't 18 and dispensing the medication. Fortunately for my article, it was not so fortunate for the social issue, but fortunately for my article. Now, before we launch into the ethics of conscientious objection, just a few very basic facts about emergency contraception, or EC, as I'm going to refer to it. Right now, there's only one emergency contraceptive that's available in the United States, and it's called Plan B, or levonorgestrel. There used to be another drug, Preven, but it is no longer available, so it's just Plan B. And basically, it's just a higher dose of progestin than is in standard contraceptives. In fact, one possible way of getting around the problems with EC is just to get regular contraceptives and take a lot of it, put a bit in brownies and take a lot of it. I don't know if it helps if you can smoke it, but anyway, all right. The primary function, which I'm sure you know, is, and it's the reason it's called emergency contraception, is if there's been unprotected sex or failed contraception, then emergency contraception is used. Now, even though it's called the morning after pill, that's a misnomer, because it does not have to be taken the morning after. Now, it should be taken as soon as possible after the incident. Its effectiveness is significantly reduced after 72 hours, but there's a belief to be some residual effect up to 120 hours after sex. But the best bet is that window between the time of sex, unprotected sex, and 72 hours, or 3 days. So time is somewhat of the essence. And women who take Plan B are advised to take a second pill 12 hours after the first one. Now, the primary mechanism, and this is there's considerable controversy about this, but there's some facts that are, well, facts. Its primary mechanism is to prevent ovulation or fertilization. It doesn't have any effect after implantation. So it does not cause the termination of pregnancy or abortion. Now, here we got to get a little technical. So what's an abortion? Well, according to OBGYNs, abortion only happens after implantation. So if Plan B has no effect after implantation, whatever it does before implantation is not called abortion. Now, the question is, well, what happens if there's fertilization, right? So the primary function of it is to prevent ovulation, prevent fertilization. Okay, so let's say there's fertilization happen. Okay, what does Plan B do? And this is where there's some controversy. This is where you can't say there's a fact. I think strongest evidence points in the direction that if fertilization has occurred, Plan B does not result in the termination of the process of development of the whatever you want to call it. So the current strongest evidence is that it has no so-called post-fertilization effect, but still there's some room for doubt about it because, obviously, for ethical reasons, it's not possible to set up a controlled clinical trial. Group of women take EC and group don't, and let's see what happens. That would not be ethical. Okay, so let's then begin by taking a look at the issue from the perspective of pharmacists. Pharmacists like the one in Chicago who have a moral and or religious objection to dispensing emergency contraception. What's at stake for them from their perspective? Why should we even think of recognizing their right to refuse to dispense a medication about which they have some moral and or religious objection? Now, one very common answer is if you didn't allow pharmacists to refuse to dispense medication that's contrary to their ethical and or religious beliefs, you would be kind of not allowing them to be professionals, right? Pharmacists are professionals, and you've got to then allow them some professional autonomy, and if you don't allow them to make decisions on the basis of their moral, ethical beliefs, you're not giving them that professional autonomy. Now, I think that's really a mistake. And, you know, what's sometimes said is, oh, well, if you just said that they couldn't use their, couldn't exercise their judgment, you'd be treating them as automatons or mere technical sales clerks, right? They're not sales clerks. They're professionals. But the reason I think that's a mistake is because, yes, they are professionals, and yes, it is important to allow them to exercise their professional judgment. Are there any contraindications? Has the physician made a mistake, like a patient is changing from Avodart to Proscar for prostatitis, for enlarged prostate? And Avodart, it turns out, it's a 0.5 milligram dosage. Proscar, it's a 5 milligram dosage. So maybe the physician just wrote down 5 for Proscar, which is 10 times as much as it should be, which probably isn't so good. Well, okay, so that's where we have pharmacists to exercise their professional judgment or to see whether the patient is taking medications that have interactions so that they shouldn't be taking all of those medications. That's where the pharmacist's professional judgment comes in. That's why they're not automatons or sales clerks. They are professionals. But when we talk about conscientious objection, we're not talking about that kind of professional judgment. We're talking about moral judgments. So what I want to suggest is that the primary reason that it's important for pharmacists to be able to refuse to fill prescriptions that violate their moral and or religious beliefs is it has to do not with their professional standing, but rather with their moral integrity. Which leads us to the next issue, which is, okay, what then is moral integrity? And here's what I want to suggest. That first of all, to talk about moral integrity means that the person has some core ethical beliefs. Now, what do I mean by core ethical beliefs? Well, basically, they're almost part of the person's identity, right? So they're not, you know, like sort of fringe beliefs about the tax code or something like that, you know. They really go to the core of the person's identity, such that if the person were forced to violate those beliefs, that would be forcing that person to do something that goes against their real core identity, what they think of themselves. And then the last condition here would have to be, of course, that the pharmacist's core ethical beliefs are opposed to emergency contraception for some reason or another. And we'll get into that a little bit more later. So what's the importance of moral integrity? Well, basically, if you're forced to violate your beliefs that form the core of your identity, obviously, it's like self-betrayal. You're being forced to do something that it's not you. And this can be very upsetting to somebody emotionally, and also it can lead to a loss of self-respect. So what I want to just suggest is that there's something very important at stake for the pharmacist if we're talking about these core ethical beliefs, if we're talking about moral integrity. Now, that's one side of the coin. Now, we also have to talk about, well, okay, but they're pharmacists, and in addition to their moral integrity, they've got, as pharmacists, they have certain professional obligations. So let's take a look at their professional obligations and then see how we can reconcile the interest in protecting moral integrity with the professional obligations of pharmacists. And I thought a good place to start would be with a Model State Pharmacy Act, which was formulated by the National Association of Boards of Pharmacy in 2003. So according to this board, and this is, the Model State Pharmacy Act, pharmacy is a professional practice which affects the public health, safety, and welfare, and is subject to regulation and control in the public interest. Okay, so we have some notion here that pharmacy has certain obligations to the public, and it's appropriate to regulate that profession so that it is consistent with this goal or end. They talk about what's unprofessional conduct. Well, what is unprofessional conduct according to the board? It's engaging in conduct likely to deceive, defraud, or harm the public, or demonstrating a willful or careless disregard for the health, welfare, or safety of a patient, or engaging in conduct which is substantially departs from the standards of care ordinarily exercised by a pharmacist. They also point out that, well, pharmacy is a profession. It's not a commercial business. So, let's compare pharmacy with used car salespeople. What's the difference? Well, hopefully used car salespeople, although they don't necessarily live up to this, they're not supposed to use force and fraud, right? So there are some ethical constraints that apply even to used car salespeople. But pharmacists, in addition to not being able to use force or fraud, they have certain fiduciary obligations, as we've seen. And that's what it means to be a profession. So they have to look out for the welfare, the well-being of their clients, of their patients, and salespeople, car salespeople, don't have to look out for my welfare or well-being. They can sell me a lemon if I'm stupid enough to buy it. They just can't use force or fraud to do that. They can use my gullibility. Now, to be even more specific, let's take a look quickly at the Code of Ethics, American Pharmacists Association, a number of obligations of pharmacists. There's an obligation to promote the good of every patient in a caring, compassionate, and confidential manner. An obligation to place concern for the well-being of the patient at the center of professional practice. So this is the fiduciary notion. The well-being of the patient is an obligation of pharmacists. An obligation to serve patients in a private and confidential manner. An obligation to respect the autonomy and dignity of each patient. And finally, an obligation to serve individual, community, and societal needs. Now, obviously, pharmacists have incentives to fulfill those obligations. Because if they don't, they'll get in trouble. Right? So in that respect, we can say, well, okay, so pharmacists have a good reason to fulfill their obligations. But I want to claim that it goes beyond just those kind of incentives, that there also are good ethical justifications for those kinds of for those obligations. And here now, there are a number of different accounts, and I just want to quickly identify three of them and indicate how one might go about saying that these are, in fact, they have an ethical foundation. They're not just fiats that some board sticks out to you and you say, if you're a pharmacist, you either follow it, or if you don't want to follow it, go into philosophy. So one is a social contract and commitment account. Basically, the idea here is this. There's a covenant or contract between the profession, pharmacy profession, and society. And what is it like? Well, pharmacists get certain benefits. They get certain rights and privileges. They get a monopoly on dispensing prescription medication. They get certain benefits in terms of income, in terms of professional standing. Now, in exchange for that, the pharmaceutical profession agrees to take on certain obligations to promote the well-being of people in society. And then, okay, this account continues. So that's the pact, the covenant, the contract between the profession and society. And then each individual pharmacist, when they join the profession, make a commitment to follow that contract. Okay, so that's one possible account. Now, another possible account, reciprocal justice. It highlights the same features. Pharmacists get certain benefits, certain privileges, certain rights. In return for that, society gets certain things from pharmacists in terms of promoting their well-being, et cetera, et cetera. But now, there's no talk of agreements. There's no talk, because you say, well, when did the profession ever meet with us to, you know. So here the claim is, no, it's not that there was an agreement to do this. It's rather, it's just a part of reciprocal justice. If you get some goodies, then you got to have some responsibilities. It's just a matter of justice. And the final account is just based on certain general moral principles like respect for autonomy, don't harm people, and justice. And the claim is that in the context of what pharmacists do and how they relate to the public, if you apply these rules, we can generate certain obligations like the ones that we talked about a little earlier. So those are just three ways of trying to account for the fact that pharmacists do have certain obligations that come from being professionals, obligations that ordinary people do not have. Now, how can pharmacists fail to discharge the obligation? Well, one very obvious way is they can harm people. And they can harm people in various ways. They can be negligent. They can be they can fail to have accurate information, knowledge, keep up in the field. They can have unsanitary equipment. There are all sorts of things that pharmacists can do. I guess they can be drug abusers, right? There are all sorts of things that pharmacists can do that will harm the public and that result in not discharging their obligations. But what I want to claim is that in addition to the harm that they can do by basically actually harming people, giving them the wrong medication, they can also harm people, they can also fail to fulfill their obligations by not dispensing medication. After all, medication is related to people's health needs, and if pharmacists fail to dispense medication, they can fail to promote the well-being of the populations they serve. So what I want to claim then is that there's sort of a division of labor here, that it's the physician's role to determine what patients need, what their medical needs are, and it's basically then the pharmacist's role, again, exercising her professional judgment in the circumstances, but it's the pharmacist's role then, in terms of fulfilling her obligations, to meet the medical needs of the client, of the patient, as determined by the physician. So what I want to claim then is at least there's a prima facie obligation on the part of pharmacists to dispense medication unless there's some clinical contraindication, and that obligation stems from what we talked about in terms of pharmacists' obligations to, and specifically to promote the well-being of the populations they serve. Okay, so that basically then generates a conflict, which is what philosophers love. And I suppose lawyers like it too, right? But a conflict. So on the one hand, we have the case for pharmacists, their moral integrity. They ought to be allowed to refuse to dispense medication. On the other hand, we have an obligation to dispense medication because it's very important to women to get it. So how do you resolve this conflict? And one, I think, fairly obvious approach is reasonable accommodation. And this basically is the approach that's used in Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which requires now, and this is with respect to employers, right? It requires employers, that would be pharmacies, to reasonably accommodate employees' conscience-based objections by means that don't impose undue hardships on the conduct of the employer's business. Okay, so that's Title VII. Now, apply the same rule to pharmacists now, not in relation to the employer, but pharmacists in relation to the populations they serve. And let's say, well, try to reasonably accommodate them without placing undue burdens or undue hardships on the clients, on the patients that they serve. Now, I think this is a reasonable approach. So why is it a reasonable approach? Well, because the goal is to take both values into account and try somehow to respect them. So you're not saying, well, we're going to opt for this side and the heck with these values, or we're going to opt for that side and the heck with those values. You're saying, well, you know, both values, moral integrity of pharmacists and serving the public, both of them are very important, but let's see if we can't somehow satisfy both of those values. That seems to be an eminently reasonable and appropriate way to try to resolve these kinds of conflicts. And it is, in fact, the way that the American Pharmacists Association recommends. They have a conscience clause which basically says pretty much the reasonable accommodation approach. They recognize the individual pharmacist's right to exercise conscientious refusal, and they support the establishment of systems to ensure patients access to legally prescribed therapy without compromising the pharmacist's right of conscience. So basically, this is a reasonable accommodation approach. How do we attain this lofty goal? And here are some fairly obvious ways, measures, means to accomplish this attempt to reasonably accommodate the pharmacists. One thing would be, well, make sure the pharmacist informs the pharmacy in advance that she will not dispense this type of medication. There are certain medications that she is religiously or morally opposed to dispensing. This would be a measure for the pharmacy to ensure that there's always somebody available who will dispense the emergency contraception. And then finally, and this is probably the most controversial, as we'll see, a proviso that pharmacists who will not dispense the medication will at least refer the patient to a pharmacy that will, and will at least facilitate a transfer of the prescription to another pharmacy. Those are measures that one might say, well, yeah, these are reasonable accommodations to the pharmacist without compromising the pharmacist's integrity and still providing access to emergency contraception. Well, unfortunately, as you may have learned, there are some people that don't like reasonable accommodations, right? Not everybody is into reasonable accommodations. So what now might you people say in opposition to what seems to be a fairly plausible approach? Well, one objection to reasonable accommodation is that it requires now indirect participation of the pharmacist, right? By virtue of having to transfer prescriptions, by virtue of having to refer patients to other pharmacies. The claim is the pharmacist is facilitating something that the pharmacist is morally opposed to. And so that's indirect participation, and that's unacceptable. So the claim is, it's as reasonable as this might have seemed, it still is violating the moral integrity of pharmacists, so it's not really a reasonable accommodation. It's a worthless gesture, but not a reasonable accommodation. And now there's a group called the Pharmacists for Life International, and so here their approach is basically just an absolute. Pharmacists don't have to do anything involving emergency contraception or any medication that they're morally or religiously opposed to. So here is as opposed now to the Pharmacists Association, here's what they recommend as the way to treat conscientious objection. They say the rights of conscience of any person being a duly licensed pharmacist who shall object on personal, ethical, moral, or religious grounds to the performance of any act, and I underline this, of any act in the normal course of professional performance or dispensing shall be respected. And further, such a refusal to perform any act or the omission of any act based on such a claim of conscience shall not form the basis, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so this is basically now the view that the pharmacist, as a matter of conscience, to protect his moral integrity, ought to be forced to do absolutely nothing. Patient walks in with a prescription for EC, and you just say what the pharmacist said. I don't do that. Bye. Now, let's take a look briefly at the law. After all, it's supposed to be with law and medicine. So now, what about states? What do states deal? How do states deal with this problem, this issue? Four states permit pharmacists to refuse to dispense emergency contraception, and this is explicit. It refers specifically to pharmacists. Five other states don't specifically mention pharmacists, but they're very broadly worded, healthcare professionals, whatever, and it's understood to include pharmacists. So that makes a total of 9 states. Now, there are some states that have the kind of broad protection that the Pharmacists for Life International endorsed. Mississippi is one of them. Here's Mississippi's law. A healthcare provider has the right not to participate, and no healthcare provider shall be required to participate in a healthcare service that violates his or her conscience. And now, here's their definition of participation. To participate is to counsel, advise, provide, perform, assist in, refer for, admit for purposes of providing, or participate in providing. Good grief, right? In other words, it's the kind of absolute, you don't have to do anything. So this is not a reasonable accommodation statute. Now, what kind of objections are there to this broad, absolute right to refuse that Mississippi and some other states endorse? What's the problem with it? Well, some people say, especially philosophers, probably some lawyers as well, that the underlying conception of moral responsibility is just unacceptable, right? The claim that you're violating your moral integrity if you just tell somebody, go down the street 2 blocks to Rite Aid and you can get your prescription fulfilled, that involves a somehow infringement on moral integrity. Some people say that's just a flawed interpretation of moral responsibility. Now, there's a couple of problems with that response. Let's see, do I have that? Okay, I think it's the next slide. And then the next objection is, let's see, let me just see. Okay, no, gotta do it there, or I don't do it at all. Okay, the problem with this, okay, what's the problem with this, very, very briefly? Well, a couple of problems. First, this is very controversial. I mean, what is the correct understanding of moral responsibility? So that's one. The second problem is, look, if we're talking about conscientious objection, respecting people's moral beliefs, then we're not doing that because we're saying here's the right moral belief about moral responsibility. So those are two basic problems with this response or this objection. Now, there's another response that I think is more appropriate, and that is that, well, think about it. Generally, claims of conscience are not absolute. If you think of certain models, like military objection to the military draft, well, people who object to the military draft, they can become conscientious objectors, but then they have to serve, they have to perform alternate service, sometimes even more risky, like being a medic. But the point is not that a burden is put on them, but they're still part of the military establishment. So they're indirectly involved. Or I still remember during Vietnam, some people were protesting their taxes because they were war taxes. Well, and they said, that's indirectly contributing to the war. Well, the government said, too bad, doesn't matter. So there are a lot of cases where indirect participation, there's a line drawn between direct and indirect participation. And then finally, to give this kind of broad, blanket, absolute protection to pharmacists would forget something that's very important, which is, and the New York Times says this very, very bluntly, I think, right, that a pharmacist who can't dispense medicines lawfully prescribed by a doctor should find another line of work. Now, what the New York Times is basically reminding us is that pharmacists have those professional obligations that we talked about. Now, the problem is what the New York Times is forgetting is that pharmacists are also moral agents. Right. So once again, we could say here, the problem with the absolute position here is that it's failing to recognize a very important point, which is pharmacists are pharmacists as well as moral agents. Now, very quickly, another case, and this is a case of a pharmacist in Wisconsin who refused to fill a prescription for oral contraceptives. And now in this case, the woman had a prescription on file at the pharmacy for oral contraceptives, and he refused to facilitate a transfer. What happened is the woman went to another pharmacy. The pharmacy called Nesson's pharmacy, and Nesson said, I'm not going to transfer it to you. That would compromise my moral integrity. Now, in this case, the pharmacy board actually sanctioned Nesson and found his action incompatible with his professional obligations. And the reasons they gave is, first of all, they said, well, okay, he didn't notify the manager of the pharmacy in advance. That's one of the measures we talked about earlier. And secondly, he failed to provide some assistance to the patient to get her medication elsewhere. In other words, he refused any kind of indirect participation, and the board found that to be unacceptable professional conduct. And interestingly enough, just last month, a three-judge panel of the Wisconsin Third District Court upheld the board's ruling, and here's a part of what they said. They said that they accepted the board's finding that the standard of care required Nesson to truthfully inform his employers of his, so inform in advance, and also to make arrangements to accommodate the needs of patients. So what they found then, basically, is reasonable accommodation is necessary, and they found against this kind of absolute claim of no participation at all. Now, quickly some other issues. Well, objection versus obstruction. And I think what one could claim is that Nesson went over the line from objection, I'm not going to participate, I'm not going to compromise my moral integrity, to preventing the woman from getting her emergency contraception. And you think you could make a distinction between saying, look, the purpose of recognizing conscious objection is so that the pharmacist doesn't have to do something that is contrary to his or her moral beliefs, but it does not entitle the pharmacist to interfere with the person getting the medication on her own. And one could claim that that's what this pharmacist did. Privacy and dignity of patients. Well, the woman in this case requested was orthocycline. Is that what it is? The contraceptive? Is that what it's called? Tricycline? What is it? Orthocycline. Okay, orthocycline. So she, is that, am I right? Tell me what it is. That's what I wrote about. Thank you. Okay. Orthocycline. So, and now that has multiple uses. It can be used to treat various problems with menstrual cycles, various hormonal problems that women might have. It can be used to treat acne. So the pharmacist then asked the woman, well, why do you want this? And I think one could claim that this was an invasion of privacy. Now, question. Is it appropriate to assess a pharmacist's reasons for refusing to dispense? I think this is a very important question when we get to conscientious objection, right? When, in the case of the military draft, people who wanted to claim conscientious objection were subjected to an enormous cross-examination, right? I mean, it makes the treatment that Obama got in the debate look like a love fest, what you would get from your draft board. So the question is, well, what about when pharmacists refuse? Now, I think that basically respect for moral integrity means we have to be very careful about how much we interrogate people about their moral and religious beliefs, right? It'd be dangerous to sort out reasonable beliefs from unreasonable beliefs. So we've got to be very, very careful. But I think there are at least two exceptions to this general rule. Don't probe for reasons. Don't try to sort out good reasons from bad reasons. One is if the pharmacist's objection is based on a belief that is just clearly contrary to the goals of pharmacy. Now, only a philosopher would think of this example, I grant you. But here's an example of what I mean. Let's say a pharmacist believes that pain is deserved. It's God's sign that you're a bad person. So the pharmacist then is religiously opposed to dispensing pain medication. Now, it seems to me that that should not be recognized, that it's part of the goal of the pharmacy profession to provide pain relief to people. And if you're there, I think the New York Times statement applies. If that's your belief, then go into either law or philosophy, because that's filled with pain. Now, finally, the mistaken clinical belief. Here's a study that's actually quite shocking. A study of pharmacists, well, they were in South Dakota, so maybe it's not that shocking. It's found that 43% accepted and 31% expressed uncertainty about the incorrect statement that emergency contraception can cause birth defects. So 43% had a false belief about the effect of emergency contraception. 21% believe that the repeated use of emergency contraception poses health risks. And again, that's a false belief. Now, that has nothing to do with conscientious objection, right? This would just be the pharmacist then would give false information to the patient or might be disinclined to dispense, not for reasons of conscience, but just because of false beliefs. But here's now something that I think does get to conscientious objection, which is almost 37% didn't correctly identify the mechanism of action of emergency contraception. And 19% incorrectly identified it as most similar to the abortifacient mifepristone. Now, that, I think, is really problematic, because if the pharmacist is refusing to dispense emergency contraception because she believes that it's like mifepristone, that's wrong. And suppose you informed this pharmacist, wait a minute, now that's not at all how it works. And then she said, oh, well, in that case, right, never mind. You have to be old to remember that from Saturday night. Anyway, if that's the case, then you say, well, gee, maybe there is some room here for examining the reasons of the pharmacist. Again, this is not as controversial as sorting out reasonable from unreasonable religious beliefs. How are we doing on time? Bad. Let's rushing through here. What I call conscience clause legislation without a conscience clause. There are some states that have so-called conscience clauses which allow conscientious objection, which basically don't say anything about the conscience or about religious or moral beliefs. Here's South Dakota. It just says no pharmacist may be required to dispense, and that's it. Right? I won't even bother reading it, but it doesn't say if the pharmacist is religiously or morally opposed to it. It's just nobody is required to do these things. And now, in the case of, just for time, I'll just take my word for it. and now, this was a proposed amendment to an Indiana law. The red stuff is the proposed amendment. And basically, again, if you look at number two there, it just says you don't have to dispense EC or birth control. You just don't have, and it doesn't say if you're religiously opposed to it. So what I read off of this is that this is actually masking for a respect for conscience. It's masking for respect for moral integrity. What I think the hidden agenda here is in these kinds of laws is to eradicate certain kinds of practices, right? And this is really trying to just eliminate dispensation of contraceptives or emergency contraception. We can talk about it, but I think that's what's going on here. So let's wrap up by going back to Illinois. And I won't read through this for time, but basically, take my word for it, Illinois has a conscience clause that enables pharmacists to refuse to dispense emergency contraception on grounds of religion or ethics. Now, remember, they also have this rule that requires pharmacies, if they dispense contraceptives, to dispense them all. So it doesn't take a brain surgeon or a rocket scientist to figure out, oi, there's going to be some conflicts here. On the one hand, the pharmacy is required by law, if they dispense contraceptives, to dispense emergency contraception. On the other hand, the law recognizes the right of pharmacists to not dispense emergency contraception. So what can happen? Well, you've got a pharmacy now that says, well, gee, we need to get a pharmacist who dispenses EC. How do we do that? Well, we asked them, do you dispense EC? If the pharmacist says no, according to law, we can't not hire you because according to the law, we can't discriminate. So I think this puts the law really at loggerheads, and again, what it requires is to think about this a little bit and say, how are we going to resolve these conflicts? And to end, let me just suggest that in resolving these conflicts, I think what is appropriate is to avoid both extremes. One extreme expressed by the New York Times, which is if you can't do it, get another profession. And the other extreme, the Pharmacists for Life International, no participation whatsoever. And again, what I would recommend is that there be some reasonable accommodation, which means basically try to set it up so that pharmacists have this opportunity to refuse to do things that violate their moral and religious beliefs, but at the same time provide the service to the patient. And to be totally symmetrical, I'll end with another cartoon, and I'll let you interpret this the way you want to. Okay, thank you very much for your patience. Do we have time for questions? I'm willing to take questions for anybody who's willing to stick around.
I know there's a couple of people who have classes that are starting, so we have to leave for class, okay? Then we can have a couple of questions.
Yes. If they, the law is if they dispense contraception. So they can just say, we don't dispense contraception. But if they, then each pharmacy has to dispense all contraceptives. Right. Well, that's why I remember at the very beginning, and that was, you know, 2 years ago, right? But at the very beginning, I said that there's, I think, an important distinction between pharmacies and pharmacists. And my view is, precisely for the reason you stated, that pharmacies have an obligation to provide for the health needs of the populations they serve. So if you have a rural community that has one pharmacy, then that pharmacy does not have the right to say, we don't dispense emergency contraception. Now, what's more tricky is if a larger city where there are lots of different pharmacies, right? You say, well, as long as it's not an undue burden. But what's an undue burden? Right? I mean, it's 2 miles away, but somebody doesn't have a car. It's 2 miles away. Somebody can't get there, and they don't deliver. And so what my view is that since it's so difficult to take on a case-by-case basis, do we need this pharmacy to dispense in order to satisfy the health needs of the community? My view of it is it should be a blanket requirement. Every pharmacy has to dispense medication that is important for the community. Now, if it's a retirement community, you probably don't need contraceptives. Well, maybe I'm being unfair there. You probably still do. And I'm getting close to that, so I better be careful. Did you want to follow up? Right. Want to do it. Well, that's why I think, and that, you know, that's the problem in Illinois, and I think that the pharmacy has an obligation to get personnel who will satisfy the health needs of the community. That's my view. Now, I know people can disagree, but that's my view. Because, remember now, pharmacies are not just businesses, right? They are serving the community. They're regulated. They have a monopoly. And I think given all of that, it's appropriate, it's justified to impose certain obligations on them to do what they're supposed to do. And if they don't, then I think the New York Times thing, okay, so if you are somebody who is really opposed to that, then go into law, go into philosophy, go into dental hygiene, but, right? I mean, it's a doleful, you're right, you know, so there's going to be certain situations where it's just going to have to be, okay, we're going to enforce this. But I think in most situations, it's possible to accommodate everybody. Yeah, and then, yeah. Right.
And do you think that is attendable to you, and how do you think that will affect a pharmacist being involved at all?
Well, that's a good question. Now, the problem is, with emergency contraception, it's emergency contraception. And you could say, well, just plan ahead. But think about it. Some of the people who are using emergency contraception didn't plan ahead. That's why they need emergency contraception. I mean, it's not everybody that's been raped or, you know, the whatchamacjingy flipped or whatever slipped. Or it's sometimes people just aren't prepared. They don't plan ahead. So, you know, it's going to alleviate some of them, as did, you know, the FDA approval for the sale without a prescription eliminated some of the problem, but not all of it. So I think this, it's still going to linger, I think. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Yeah, I think you raise a very, very important point. And, you know, I try as much as possible not to be cynical about people's motivation or question. But I suspect that there's some people, some pharmacists, who are doing exactly what you said. But I also bet there's some pharmacists who really have this notion of participation. So it's probably a mixed bag. And okay. Okay. Well, the reason I called it cynical, maybe cynical wasn't the right word, but it's, I mean, we're cynical for saying that because, but they're not cynical. It's just we're cynical saying, oh, we don't, yeah, moral integrity, yeah. What you're really trying to do is make sure that people aren't using contraceptives, because what your real agenda is to make sure that sex is just for procreation. So why the hell would you need contraceptives? Right. There are probably some people like that. But again, I think there are probably some people who really legitimately think that any involvement whatsoever is just, you know. Yes?
I have a kind of two-part question about obligations, what you said about the obligations of the pharmacists to the public.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Yeah, very good point. And I guess I would ask you this, is what I would ask then, not you, but whoever's saying this, is tell me more, tell me how this is harming the public. Right? And then they could say any number of things, some of which would be sort of more in the clinical realm, right? Like, I don't know, what would you say? It causes cancer, it causes mutations, or it causes, you know, your nose to fall off, or, you know, whatever, then I would say, okay, now you're really exercising your professional judgment as a pharmacist, and we really have to look into that, right? So the FDA ought to be doing some trials and figure out if that's really the case. Now, if they say, well, it's harm because you're doing something that's damaging to your moral fiber or something like that, right? Then I'd say, well, you know, now, wait a minute, this, again, gets into the category of conscientious objection, and that may be your view, but it's not the view of the profession, right? I mean, the profession views dispensing as being perfectly appropriate, And as long as it's the view of the profession, as long as it's the view of the FDA, as long as physicians are prescribing it, then your role as a pharmacist is to fill it. Now, and then we're going to accommodate. We are going to accommodate, but it's going to be an accommodation for your religious moral belief as opposed to, you know, what looks like a, I'm just acting in the best interest of the general public. Does that address?
I have a follow-up question.
Sure. They're the deciders. Okay. I again, it sounds to me like that's related to your first comment, which is when I said the deference, it's the deference in terms of determining what the health needs of, well, it's not just physicians, right? I mean, there's researchers, there's the drug regulator, the FDA, and then there's individual physicians. They're all kind of trying to determine whether or not a certain medication is beneficial enough to outweigh whatever risk to offer it to the public. So that's what I'm saying, that, and that's not the pharmacist's role. So that's what I would say, the deference to that judgment, which goes back to your first question, right? Now, beyond that, yes, there's an absolutely, pharmacists have a lot to say to contribute. As professionals in terms of catching mistakes that physicians make, catching not necessarily mistakes, but a patient has four different physicians and nobody's keeping tabs of what they're prescribing, and the pharmacist then is the person who's going to catch the interaction and say, wait a minute, right? So they definitely have a role. Now, I think beyond that, do they have a role to play in the kind of public discourse about the issues we've been talking about today? Absolutely. So they have a role in that respect in terms of the public discourse, right? But I just would, you know, I want to at least say that there are certain issues that are determined before the pharmacist gets that prescription, which I don't think it's the pharmacist's role to question, you know, about whether this is appropriate to be offered on the market, this medication, right?
We have time for one more question.
Yep.
Hi. This question is somewhat similar to my colleague.
My answer is the same. Oh, then I won't answer. I won't be able to answer that one. Okay, yeah. I wondered about that. People, I thought they did it voluntarily. I think that was Previn. I think it was.
You expressed skepticism about your statement that it was purely for business reasons. My first reaction was I'm shocked that Walmart admitted it was for business reasons and didn't claim they were doing it for the welfare of society or something.
Oh.
So I was curious where that's coming from. And I'll ask my second question today.
Okay. I think that Walmart. I think the reason that Walmart, at least, you can make a case for why Walmart would have thought that was a good reason to give, is that Walmart's a business, right? So if a business says, oh, we made this for business reasons, what are you going to do, right? Whereas if Walmart says, we made this for moral reasons, then people are going to say, what the hell's Walmart making moral judgments, right? And then there were a lot of people who were opposed to it, right? So that, I think, was trying to deflate that opposition, saying, look, we just decided not to carry it for business reasons. Now, if I can just go back one second to your comment. And I think that's another reason why I would endorse, those of you who know the read the article know that I endorse a general requirement of all pharmacies to carry EC is because I think some pharmacies might not do it for business reasons because of the protests that they get, the boycotts they get, the hassle they get, and they might decide it's just easier to put the burden on other pharmacies. Okay, so, yeah.
Following up on my colleague's question, suppose we had a pro-life pharmacist who said, I refuse to dispense the medication because, as Tommy, my colleague mentioned, I don't think for public health, that I think it's antithetical. But the reasons that you listed in response to this question, one example was what aims is more fiber. What if he says that from a medical standpoint, from at least a factual standpoint,
okay,
it is destructive of life, or at least his conception of life, which mm-hmm.
Well, here, I think I was going to talk about this a little, and I didn't have time, so I admit it. But I'm glad you gave me the occasion to toss it in. I do think that there is sort of a secondary justification that pharmacists can give for refusing to dispense certain medications, and that is just what you said. They can say, look, the profession of pharmacy is about life. Now, I think the clearest example of that is Oregon, where they have a law that allows physicians to prescribe medication to terminate life. I think it would make it's perfectly plausible for pharmacists in Oregon to say, look, this giving prescriptions to people, filling prescriptions that has the specific purpose for people to kill themselves, is so contrary to the goals of the pharmaceutical profession that I just, right, as a pharmacist, right, and that's what I call the norms of professional integrity. So I think there are cases where you could argue it's not only individual integrity, it's also professional integrity, which makes the case even stronger. Right. So I agree with you 100%. So it's kind of the reverse of what I said with the pain thing, right, which is it's so contrary to the goals that it takes away from its moral weight, but it can be the other way. It can add to it, right? But I think, again, it just supports the individual opting out because there are lots of decisions that have been made by lots of different actors prior to that point saying it's okay clinically, health-wise, and you know, in all these other respects, it's okay. So now the pharmacist is left only to say, well, you say it's okay, I don't, and therefore give me some space to exercise both my individual integrity and my view of what the profession ought to be doing here.
Can you think of that pharmacist then liken any kind of assistance to
being
an
accomplished murder? I can imagine somebody trying to phrase it that way. Yeah. Can you think of that? Well, now that's interesting because in Oregon, the law is a very, very strong law. It not only allows, now this is for physicians, I think it applies to pharmacists as well, but let me just talk about physicians, right? It not only allows physicians to say, I refuse to fill your prescription, but it allows the physician to refuse to refer. And the only thing the law requires the physician to do is to send off the records of the patient to somebody else. That's it. The physician has no obligation legally to counsel, to refer, anything. So you might say, well, why that? And why is that justified? And I would say, well, because this is something within the field of medicine that's very controversial. Right, it's the only state that allows it. The AMA is still officially opposed to it. So you say, look, you can make a strong case that it it really is not clear that it's compatible with the goals, with the norms of the profession. Whereas with respect to contraceptives, say, look, you can't make that kind of case. All throughout, whether it's the FDA, whether it's the AMA, whether it's the Pharmacists Association, they've all said it's okay, it's acceptable. So then it's just going to be the individual who disagrees, and you have to give that individual some space.
Okay. Professor, we again thank you for sharing with us.
My pleasure. I recognize you. Do I know you? Were you a student of my
class? No, I went to Marshall for undergrad.